Okay, great. Well, thank you everyone for joining us tonight. My name is Maura Boudreau. I do programs and publicity for the West Hartford Public Library. We're here today to talk with Leslie Goddard about Betty Crocker. Very excited. And just a couple of things before we get started. This meeting is being recorded. I'll be able to edit it tomorrow morning and send it out to everyone, and we'll be able to have it live for about 2 weeks before we take it down. If you do have any questions, what you can do is put it in the chat box to the lower right-hand corner, and Leslie will be able to answer any questions at the end of the presentation. Let me give an introduction to Leslie, and then I will turn it over to her. Leslie Goddard holds a PhD from Northwestern University and master's degrees in museum studies and in theater. She is a lifelong resident of the Chicago area who has written 2 books on Chicago history. She has been lecturing and performing on topics in history for more than 15 years. And with that, I will turn it over to Leslie.
Okay, great. Thanks. And I'll just add to that, I grew up in a Betty Crocker family, so this was a cookbook that was personally important to me. But I really, it fits my research interests. I'm very interested in women's history and in 20th century American history. So it's kind of the perfect intersection of my interests. But what really got me started on researching Betty Crocker is about 2 years ago when the lockdown for the pandemic began. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen so I can show you what sparked my interest. A lot of people, when the pandemic began, started baking. I remember it was suddenly difficult to find chocolate chips and flour at my local grocery store. And people I know started posting images on their social media that looked like this. Failed baking projects like cookies that burned and cakes and breads that didn't rise and cookies that smooshed together and cakes that don't look like cakes. As much as we enjoy baking, or some of us do, it actually is a kind of a precise art. And if you don't do it regularly, it can be difficult to get good, consistent results. And it turns out the problems that people were having in 2020 are really not that different from the problems people were having 100 years ago. In fact, Betty Crocker became famous helping people get better baking results. This is a 1930s Betty Crocker ad. Over on the left, there's a picture of a cake with an X through it, and it says, "Why the wrong flour spoiled this cake." Betty Crocker's initial celebrity came from helping people get better baking results. So, who was Betty Crocker? If you are like me and you never thought about it for a long time, you might actually be surprised when I tell you Betty Crocker is not real. I know, right? She never was. She was completely made up. She's one of those names that is really well known in American society, but most people don't ever ask. In fact, when I started this research, I Googled Betty Crocker, and one of the suggested questions was, do you want to know when Betty Crocker died? So where did Betty Crocker begin? She was actually the brainchild of an advertising campaign for this company, the Washburn Crosby Flour Milling Company of Minneapolis. If you have really good eyesight, you might be able to tell. Over on the right is their best-selling product, gold medal flour. They actually entered a flour milling competition in the 1880s, and one of their flours won, yes, a gold medal. So they started putting a lot of their advertising budget towards promoting gold medal flour. It was their signature product. And that is what led to Betty Crocker's career. And here's how it happened. Exactly 100 years ago, well, November of 1921, so 101 years ago, Washburn Crosby took out an ad on the back page of the Saturday Evening Post. Do you remember that great magazine? And here's what it was. It was a jigsaw puzzle. This is actually the completed puzzle. It was little triangles, and they told readers, cut out the triangles, assemble them into this cute little, it's an image of a main street. Here's a close-up of it with this gold medal flower truck coming down the street. And they could send it in, you know, glue it or tape it down and send it to Washburn Crosby, and they would send you a premium. And the premium that they sent out was, and this is adorable, a little pincushion in the shape of a sack of gold medal flour. And if you can see my thumbnail, I actually have one. I found it, I think, on eBay. And it might not be that surprising because they got a great response. 30,000 people sent in finished puzzles and got their pincushions. But here's what really did surprise them. Along with the puzzles, a lot of people sent in letters with questions about baking problems, like, why does my cake sometimes not rise? Or is there any way to keep the crust of my pie from burning? Now, when we look back, it might not be that surprising. If you think about the typical kitchen of the 1920s, pan sizes were fairly new. Standardized pan sizes only dated from about 1904. Oven regulators were pretty new. In other words, it was right around World War I that ovens started to be introduced where you could set the temperature. Prior to that, and you might remember, recipes would say things like bake in a hot oven or bake in a moderate oven. That was from the pre-regulator era. Certainly compared to today, there were not nearly as many cookbooks. Not everybody had the ability to get good consistent oven temperatures with good consistent pan sizes. So the ad department, which got these letters, went to the company's home services department. This was a small staff of home economists. They were the ones who usually spent their time coming up with recipes, using Washburn Crosby products, and testing out how it worked. So these women wrote out the answers and the ad men wrote a letter and sent it to the consumers. But then it occurred to the head of the advertising department that a businessman might not be the most credible source of advice for the typical consumer, because most supermarket and grocery store, I guess grocery store in those days, purchasers of flour were women, housewives. He was thinking he might be able to build a stronger relationship between the company and its target consumers if the advice came from a woman, another housewife just like you. And specifically, if it all came from the same woman. So he invented this sort of fictional head of correspondence who he named Betty Crocker. So where did he get that name? Well, Crocker, believe it or not, was the last name of a recently retired director at Washburn Crosby, William Crocker. I'm sure he never dreamed that his name would live on, but it has. Betty was chosen just because it sounded friendly and wholesome. Betty was the fourth most popular woman's name in America in the 20s. And then they went even farther. They asked every woman who worked at Washburn Crosby to submit what they thought should be Betty Crocker's signature. This is the winning signature. So from then on, anyone sending out advice from the company about baking or cooking or anything domestic would have to know how to sign that signature. So pretty soon there's all these letters coming out. Here's a typical one. This was someone asking for what to do for high altitude cooking. And I love this because someone who worked at Betty Crocker Kitchen said, someone wrote to them once saying, I understand you need to adapt recipes for high altitude. Well, I live on the 100th floor of a skyscraper in Chicago. What should I do? And they wrote back and said, you're probably just fine. maybe not the 100th floor, maybe it was the 70th floor. It was high up there, whatever. In any case, pretty soon, it's so successful that people are constantly writing to Betty Crocker for advice. In fact, the Home Services Department staff, and here's another publicity photo of them, had to be expanded. They actually had to increase it from 5 people to 23 people. They were sometimes nicknamed the Crockerettes. And I love this photo because if you look at the setting, it's the kitchen, right? It looks like someone's home. There's little checked curtains at the window, the stove and the oven. They're using the same appliances people would use in their own homes. It's a home. But if you look at the women, they're all wearing white lab coats. They all have their hair perfectly coiffed. They're all wearing makeup. They are professionals, which they were. These were usually women with academic training in home economics. And in a lot of ways, this is exactly what Betty Crocker did so well. She seemed to be a homemaker just like you, but at the same time, she was a professional with training and expertise who had advice you can trust. Well, it doesn't take long before they started using the Betty Crocker name to give some credibility to recipes. This is actually a wooden recipe box. They started offering this in 1926. It was for 70 cents, you could get a wooden box and a starter set of index card recipes. And then with every sack of gold medal flour that you purchased, they would include a coupon you could send in to get a new set of recipes. On the inside cover of this box is a little note and it's signed by Betty Crocker herself. And later they started offering softbound cookbooks with Betty Crocker's name. But what really shoots Betty Crocker into super celebrity status is that in 1924, the company launched a Friday morning radio show. Originally, it was the Gold Medal Home Services Talks. Later, it became the Betty Crocker Cooking School on the Air. It debuted on a Minneapolis radio station, pretty much saved that radio station from bankruptcy, and was a big success. Pretty soon, it was broadcasting daily, and it soon spread nationwide. Now, Betty Crocker on the radio was largely the invention of this woman, Marjorie Child Husted, the company's longtime field rep in home economics. She wrote the radio scripts for 10 years. She established the original writing voice of Betty Crocker, the tone and the phrasing, the kind of scripts that made people feel like they were in Betty Crocker's living room listening to her give out advice. The radio programs all had this wonderful tone. You know, some man is saying, you know, my wife is such a good cook and we have a small house, but some of my buddies said they really want a home-cooked meal with a lemon pie. She doesn't think she can make a lemon pie in our tiny kitchen. Can you help? Of course, I've got the perfect recipe, and on and on and on. It's a very distinctive, compassionate, but expert kind of a voice. Now, actually on the radio, different women provided the voice of Betty. Husted did some of it, but there were others. Agnes White Tizard was the voice of Betty for a long time, and Blanche Ingersoll. Funny side note, the original radio station, WCCO, Washburn Crosby Company, in the 1920s, it had a pretty limited range in the Midwest. So every radio station outside its range had to hire their own Betty Crocker actress. So if you traveled the country in the 20s, there'd be a different Betty Crocker voice depending on where you were. It wasn't until like 1936 that everyone nationwide heard the same Betty Crocker voice. This radio station was on the air for 24 years, which is a huge run. And maybe this is a good point to step back for a minute. Betty Crocker might seem unique today because we don't typically see these fictional spokespeople for big companies. But in the 30s, 40s, and 50s, she was only one of a number of women who were fictional, but widely known for their culinary expertise. For example, Martha Logan, she was the fictional spokeswoman for Swift shortening. So these recipes that seemed to come from her actually came from the home economics team at Swift shortening. International Harvester had Irma Harding. Irma Harding's initials just happened to be the same as International Harvester. Mary Blake was the spokesperson for Carnation, and Pillsbury had this fictional woman named Anne Pillsbury. When you look at mid-century magazines, they will have advertisements from these fictional women right alongside advertisements by real women. This is Mary Barber, who was the longtime spokeswoman for Kellogg's. So she would come up with recipes using Kellogg's cereals and tout the health benefits of Kellogg's cereals. But can you see those women in white coats around Mary Barber? Whether these spokeswomen were real or fictional, they were all backed by real trained home economists who did have actual professional expertise and did have authority in their companies. And the fictional spokeswomen were designed to do the same thing the real spokeswomen were, which was to put a friendly human face on what in reality was a very large corporation. We don't see fictional spokespeople much anymore. You know, if you buy like Martha Stewart cookware, there really is a Martha Stewart. There really was an Orville Redenbacher. But a few of them live on, including, see if this woman looks a little familiar, Miss Chiquita of Chiquita Bananas. Okay, she always was a cartoon. But she did have a human voice. She was invented in 1944 by a cartoonist for Chiquita Brands, and was enormously popular. You might actually even be able to sing perhaps the Chiquita Banana song. I am not a singer, but if you don't remember, it basically goes, I'm Chiquita Banana and I've come to say bananas have to ripen in a special way, right? She's giving advice on the health benefits or the healthiest way to eat bananas, and she's coming up with recipes. This one is ham banana rolls. It is indeed a recipe for bananas that are wrapped in slices of ham and then baked, and then you pour cheese sauce on it. It tastes about as good as it might suggest, but nonetheless, a good example of a fictional spokesperson. Maybe the oldest of them all is one who's been in the news the last couple of years, and that is Aunt Jemima. She was, from the beginning, fictional. She was invented by the Pearl Milling Company of Missouri to sell their self-rising pancake mix because it gave the mix this feeling of something from the old South where you might have had a mammy in the kitchen making pancakes on the open hearth. She was portrayed starting in at the World's Columbian Exposition in 1893. She was portrayed by a succession of African-American women who would dress up as Southern mammies and do pancake making demonstrations. Her image was updated over the years. They got rid of the headscarf. They made her look more like a businesswoman, but the Southern mammy image, and even the term aunt, which was used in the South pre-Civil War and sometimes after for those not deemed worthy of the honorific Mrs., is now today seen as a very demeaning racial stereotype. So just this year, they actually have renamed it the Pearl Milling Company pancake mix. So same mix, same pancake syrup, just a different name. All right, let's go back to Betty. During World War II, Betty became kind of an activist. This is a booklet called Your Share, How to Prepare Appetizing, Healthful Meals with Foods Available Today. This was put out by General Mills. In 1928, Washburn Crosby merged with a couple of other mills. So you might recognize the name General Mills today. It's full of advice, how to deal with food shortages during the war, how to make nutritious meals using foods that might be difficult to find, or the foods that are easy to find but you're not familiar with. So it's got things like lunchbox menus, how to give your person going off to a wartime factory a healthy lunch, and recipes. This is one of my favorites. This is emergency steak. You mix together a pound of ground beef with milk and chopped onion and Wheaties, just happens to be another good General Mills product. You pat it into the shape of a T-bone steak, broil it, and voila, you can stretch 1 pound of ground beef to serve 6 people. It's actually not that good. The Wheaties kind of soak up all the grease, but it's a good example of the kind of advice that was needed. About 7 million copies of this booklet were given out during World War II. And I think you could argue Betty was at the peak of her popularity in the 40s. She was averaging 4,000 to 5,000 letters a week. One company's executive said she gets about 4 to 5 marriage proposals every week. One company spokesperson said that their surveys were showing 9 out of 10 American housewives knew who Betty Crocker was. And then it nearly all came to an end because in April 1945, Fortune magazine ran this article about General Mills. And they started out with praise. They said, Betty Crocker is the second most recognized woman in the United States. Do you want to guess who was the most recognized? Eleanor Roosevelt. So Betty is in good company. But then they outed Betty Crocker as a fake. And the company had really been trying to keep that tucked under. They didn't really want to emphasize that she was fictional. So the question is, are people going to feel like they've had this fraud foisted on them? Are they going to be angry that she's fake? Well, the answer is no. And I actually think that is revealing. This article did not hurt Betty Crocker's popularity at all, which kind of tells us Betty Crocker didn't need to be real. She was fulfilling a very real need among American housewives, giving out useful advice and useful recipes, giving housewives confidence, but also saying, in essence, cooking and baking are not insignificant tasks that anyone can do. They're important skills that should be valued, and you can do it. You just might need a little bit of help, and I'm here to provide the help and advice that you need. As long as she was able to do that, she really didn't need to be real. All right, well, if Betty Crocker's not real, then who's the lady in the portrait, right? If we go back to that 1930s ad I showed you, Betty Crocker's portrait had been appearing in ads since at least the mid-30s. Who's that lady? By the way, you'll typically see her with brunette hair and a red and white outfit, but I want to show you a rare image. Early on, they commissioned just a few pictures of her in other colors. This is the cover of my Betty Crocker picture cookie book. Betty Crocker's wearing green in this image. Much more likely to see her in red. This is the first official portrait of Betty. It was painted in 1936 by an artist named Nasa McMain. And they used this portrait for more than 20 years, which is longer than any other individual portrait. But she got a makeover. In 1955, they made her a smiling grandmotherly character. She's got sort of gray streaks in her hair at the temple. 10 years later, they sort of lopped off about 15 years and gave her a bit of a Jackie Kennedy bouffant hairdo. And there have been periodic changes ever since, although you'll notice she keeps the brown hair. She usually has blue eyes. They're just updating her clothes and her hairdo. Do you remember in the 80s when women often wore those floppy bow ties? Of course, Betty has those. For the 75th anniversary in 1996, a painter named John Stuart Ingall created this image, and he gave her brown eyes and a kind of an olive skin tone that could belong to some different ethnicities. He painted this portrait by an image created, by digitally morphing photographs of 75 American women. General Mills had chosen these 75 women because they embodied the spirit of Betty Crocker. When we look at these images as a whole, I think we get a kind of visual example of one of the keys to Betty Crocker's success, or the success of the brand. It's the brand's ability, Betty Crocker's ability, to constantly evolve while keeping certain things the same. With the images, the look is evolving to stay modern and up to date, but certain things are staying the same at the same time. And we see that in the company's use of Betty Crocker in a much bigger way. They keep certain things the same, namely the message, cooking and baking deserve respect, you can do it, you just need a little bit of help and advice. And there's a constant message that serving your family delicious food is an act of love. You know, that lemon pie is a way to show your husband and your and his guests how much you like them. All right, let's look at some other ways the company was good at updating the brand. In 1949, they hired Adelaide Holly Cumming to portray Betty Crocker on television. Holly actually later admitted that she really wasn't much of a cook. She did not like domestic work at all, but it really didn't matter. She had media experience. She'd had her own radio show. She had this really warm presence. So I want to show you just a bit of a clip from the first Betty Crocker television show from 1950. I'm just going to show a few minutes, see if we can get this to play. Go back. Here we go.
Hello, everybody. On behalf of General Mills and its many and varied services, a warm welcome to our Betty Crocker kitchens. This is an extremely important day to me and for everyone on our home service staff, too.
Do you notice how they don't have her in a kitchen? She's sitting behind a desk. She's got a nameplate. It could be her home, and she's dressed a lot like a housewife, but they're giving her a bit of that professional expertise. Sadly, a full Betty Crocker TV show never worked as well as the radio show. Americans loved listening to Betty, but there might have been something just too real about seeing her fully embodied. Most of the work that Cumming did was in TV commercials or sometimes talk shows that she did appearances on. But that's only one of many modernizations that they did. Starting in 1929, the company had this popular coupon program. You could collect coupons on company product packages and send them in to get big discounts on flatware or silver plate. So grandmothers would save up flatware for their granddaughters, or moms would collect them for their own kitchens. After a while, coupons were printed on product packages of a whole number of General Mills products. They even had a catalog for a while of things you could get with your Betty Crocker coupons. This coupon program lasted all the way to 2006. Starting in 1954, they hosted the Betty Crocker search for the All-American Homemaker of Tomorrow. This let high school seniors compete for prizes and scholarships based on really hard written tests about cooking and baking and household management. I actually had one woman, if you can see my thumbnail, she actually gave me the pin that she received. She won her high school's Betty Crocker search, which when you think about it, typically homemakers don't get a lot of awards and ribbons and prizes for putting dinner on the table. This was a way to recognize, again, that homemaking skills deserve certain respect. This competition continued all the way to 1977. Most importantly, though, the corporate kitchens were constantly updated to reflect the most modern ovens and kitchen appliances, and they were constantly testing new recipes to reflect the way Americans cooked. They would solicit recipes, develop their own versions of those recipes. They would send them out to be tested by a small group of testers, get feedback, rewrite the recipes, send them out to a larger group of testers. It was a triple step process to try and make the recipes as easy and foolproof as possible. But the biggest shift in the brand came in 1941 when they launched the first Betty Crocker grocery product. Do you want to guess what the first Betty Crocker grocery product was? If you guessed Betty Crocker cake mix, you'd be wrong. Believe it or not, it was Betty Crocker soup mix, which was not very good, and it was pulled from the market very quickly. But the next product was a big hit, and that was the Betty Crocker cake mix, which debuted in 1947. General Mills was actually late to the game. The first American cake mixes appeared in 1933. By 1947, there were 200 companies making cake mixes, either regionally or nationally. But General Mills was seeing a decline in flour sales, so they were hoping mix sales would balance out the decline in flour. Now, a lot of American housewives, this is hard to believe today, but a lot of housewives were reluctant to use cake mixes. You know, cakes are something special. That's what we make for family birthdays or graduations. A lot of women felt they had a responsibility to bake a homemade cake. One of the ways that the Betty Crocker cake mixes got around those hesitancies was to ask homemakers to add their own eggs. Towards the upper left of this ad for honey spice cake mix, it says, "You add the eggs for that special homemade goodness." Now, the reality is you can make a cake mix with powdered eggs and your cake will turn out. But asking homemakers to add their own eggs kind of made it seem a little bit more like a homemade cake. There's a little bit more work put into it. Not a lot. It's still very easy. And it doesn't hurt that fresh eggs actually do make it taste a little bit better. I want to show you an early Betty Crocker cake mix commercial. Notice two things. Number one, the emphasis on fresh eggs. And number two, notice whose face you see in this commercial. There are two humans, but you only see one face.
When you make a cake from a mix, which do you want? A fresh egg cake or a cake made with dried eggs? For higher, lighter, tastier cake, why, fresh eggs, of course. But remember, all cake mixes are not alike. Betty Crocker cake mixes are different. They call for your eggs, added by you at home. It's the only national cake mix brand that lets you add the eggs. There's a reason why there are no dried egg whites, no dried egg yolks in Betty Crocker cake mixes. When you add the eggs, you're sure to get finer cakes most consistently. 9 out of 10 homemakers in recent tests said Betty Crocker cake mixes gave them bigger, taller cakes than the dried egg cake mixes they tested. Yes, and better tasting cakes, too. Try Betty Crocker party cake mix for yellow, white, or spice cakes. And try Betty Crocker chocolate devil's food cake mix for rich, moist devil's food with genuine fresh egg goodness. Get Betty Crocker cake mixes today.
Did you notice in that commercial, you don't see the homemaker's face? All you see are her hands, and she's doing the mixing and pouring things in. The character you see is the man, and presumably this is the 1950s, he's the husband, and how delighted he is to eat that slice of cake. By the way, who eats a slice of cake that way? He picks it up like it's a sandwich. The distinct selling points for the Betty Crocker cake mixes were that the product itself tastes delicious. It'll make people happy. Serving your family delicious food is an act of love. Betty Crocker cake mixes really help make mixes the standard that they are today in so many of our family pantries. They even made mixes that kids could use. Do you remember the Easy Bake Oven, these kids' toy ovens, and they would bake a cake using heat from light bulbs, right? Betty Crocker did not invent the Easy Bake Oven, but about 5 years after it debuted, they started making cake mixes and frosting mixes. So building a relationship with young bakers long before they ever baked a cake in a full-size oven. But I think the biggest step in Betty Crocker came in 1950 when they launched the first edition of the Betty Crocker Picture Cookbook. This is a drawing from that cookbook. This cookbook debuted with an initial print run, and I'm not making this up, of 950,000 copies. It was enormous. The Chicago Tribune called this cookbook the best general cookbook ever published. Within 2 years, it was into its seventh printing and it had had 2 million copies sold. So, what made it so popular? Well, number one, it was a general cookbook. It featured easy and inexpensive recipes for everyday standards. These are not exotic recipes calling for ingredients you've never heard of. It's everyday standards, things like macaroni and cheese and meatloaf and ham loaf and tuna casserole, things like that. But there's more to it. There were other cookbooks already out that were good general cookbooks. There's a couple other things that make this cookbook distinctive. First of all, each recipe uses that triple test process, so they make them pretty easy to follow. But even more than that, this was a picture cookbook. It has step-by-step photos. If you never have sifted and measured flour, well, this is the way to do it, right? It assumed very little knowledge on the part of the reader. There are photographs of common kitchen utensils. There are full color photographs of a lot of the finished products. There had been picture cookbooks before, photos in cookbooks before, but never anything quite this lavishly illustrated. They even had little whimsical drawings. This is a woman apparently making waffles over an open hearth. I don't know how historically accurate that is, but they're really, really charming. But especially those step-by-step procedures. If you never made an angel food cake before, well, here's how you separate eggs. Here's what the egg whites look like, beaten to a stiff peak. Here's what the cake looks like when it's ready to come out of the oven. If you need to know something like how to frost a two-layer cake, or what to serve to a sick child, or how long to boil an artichoke, it's all here. It's like a home economics class in a book, which helps explain why, and this might apply to some of us tonight, it was for a long time the standard bridal shower present. A lot of brides got this book. Now, if we look through it today, it's really rooted in 1950 cooking. I don't know how many of us might boil an artichoke for 45 to 60 minutes. It has a lot of recipes for gelatin salad. I don't know if anyone remembers, but tomato aspic used to be a popular thing. It's essentially tomato jello. You could put chicken in it and make chicken tomato aspic. Why not? But Betty is never one to stand still. almost as soon as the first edition was out, they were going back and reassessing every recipe for the second edition, which debuted in 1956. This is the cover of that one. The 1961 edition has this Mondrian style, yellow and blue and pink cover. This one tends to be the most sought after edition on online websites, auction websites. The 1969 version has this pie-shaped montage of photos. So sometimes it's called the Red Pie Cookbook. Note, by 1969, the word picture has been dropped. By that point, most cookbooks had pictures. By 1986, the look is much more modern, but it's still got the red and white color and her signature. The company even published a facsimile of the 1950 edition in 1998. Over the years, the recipes from the 1950 book had been, a lot of them had been dropped, and people got really nostalgic because these are the recipes they grew up with in many cases. So with the facsimile cookbook, if you really want to make a pink azalea cake or chicken in tomato aspic, right? Here's the recipe. It's right here. And if you are curious, yes, the Betty Crocker cookbook is still being revised. It is now in its 12th edition, and it is still a bestseller. More than 75 million copies of this cookbook have been sold. And it's not the only Betty Crocker cookbook. There have been more than 250 Betty Crocker cookbooks published over the years. They kind of reflect changing American cooking and eating. In the 50s and the 60s, there are a lot of books for new brides and suburbanites and mothers. The Betty Crocker Cookbook for Boys and Girls that appeared in 1957. By the 70s and 80s, it's a lot of time-crunched cooking and a lot of recipes for the new interest in international foods. And by the turn of the millennium, a lot of low-fat and healthy eating cookbooks. In every case, you've got that key point that serving your family delicious food is an act of love, this powerful link between food and love. I want to show you a TV commercial from 1984 because it's kind of tongue-in-cheek using that idea of food and love, this thing of like, oh, Betty, you leave me breathless. You know what I like. I can't resist you, Betty.
Ooh, will you look at that?
In more ways than one, you leave. Your sweet talker, Betty Crocker.
Yeah, you know my weakness.
I can't resist. You leave me breathless.
You did it again.
With more than one way through my heart. You sweet talker, sweet talker, sweet talker, Betty Crocker.
I just love that commercial. Again, you might have noticed the face that you see is the recipient, we assume, of the food, presumably the husband, who is just overjoyed because this food is delicious and she knows exactly what he likes, right? Now, we can exaggerate that idea of food and love, but there's no question this is a message that has been part of the Betty Crocker brand from the beginning. And in fact, what we know of the brand today is often very much the same thing it has been from the beginning. That link between food and love, and that idea that cooking and baking can be easy, you just need Betty's help. Which kind of brings us up to today. I think it's remarkable that Betty Crocker is as well-known a presence in kitchens today as she ever has been. And the companies continue to evolve. The Betty Crocker website went live in 1997. It is today, according to one study, one of the five most visited recipe websites. If you know anyone who is a Generation Z or Generation Y, they tend not to look at actual cookbooks. They go online. I took this screenshot around, you can probably tell, the 4th of July. her Facebook page. Oh, sorry, this is Pinterest, right? She's on Pinterest, where you can find recipes and ideas organized by category. She's on Instagram. If you follow her on Instagram, there's multiple posts every day. She's even on YouTube. And I want to show you this very quick video for easy lemon thumbprint cookies. Note in this video, there is no spoken word. It's only music. You do not need to know how to speak or hear English to get it. Was 38 seconds. It kind of conveys in the shortness of the video that these cookies are easy. Obviously, you can't make them in 38 seconds, but it's very up to date in terms of knowing we only watch oftentimes short videos and that we want things that are easy. By the way, do you notice that red spoon in the upper left-hand corner? That is the current logo that they use. It actually evolved out of that original Betty Crocker signature in the red oval. It was made into an actual spoon in 1954, and it's had only minor variations. They've kind of updated the font a little bit and updated the spoon. Next time you go to a grocery store, take a look for that red spoon, because you'll see it all over the baking aisle. But you'll also see it on things like Hamburger Helper and Suddenly Salad. Do they still make that? And scalloped potatoes, a whole bunch of General Mills Betty Crocker products. Now, today, Betty Crocker is more symbolic than she is genuinely authoritative, but she still remains one of the most important culinary authorities ever invented. First edition, you can still buy, I took this photograph at my local Barnes & Noble, because you can still buy the Betty Crocker cookbook in many bookstores. First editions of the Betty Crocker picture cookbook will sell for up to and beyond $200 on eBay. It was $200 the day that I took this screenshot. Depends on the condition. Many of them are held together with duct tape and rubber bands. Now, a lot has changed, of course. You can no longer listen to Betty Crocker on the radio. You can no longer tour the kitchens, which you used to be able to do. But there are still Betty Crocker kitchens at General Mills headquarters in Golden Valley, Minnesota. They now have 19 fully equipped kitchens. They can test more than 50,000 recipes every year. And they still are. They are still continuing to develop recipes using Betty Crocker products and gold medal flour. But maybe the best indicator of how influential Betty Crocker has been comes from a list. And this is a list that was put together in 2015 by the New York Daily News of the 8 most influential fictional figures, the most influential people who never actually existed. And by golly, there was Betty Crocker right up there with Barbie and Uncle Sam and the Marlboro Man, which is pretty impressive for a woman who just turned 100 years old, right? So the next time that you are making a recipe from your Betty Crocker cookbook, just remember it all started with a sack of gold medal flour and an advertisement on the back of the Saturday Evening Post. All right, I am going to finish up there because I want to leave some time now at the end to answer questions. You know, you can move your cursor, and if you'll see that little icon that says chat, you can type your questions in there. And while you're thinking of questions, I will point out this is not my actual kitchen. You might have guessed this is a virtual image, but I love the oven on the wall. Why did they ever get rid of that? I think that was a I think that was a brilliant, brilliant idea. All right. What can I tell you?
Great. Thank you so much, Leslie. That was wonderful.
If
you have any questions, what you can do is put them in the chat box or you can raise your hand.
Oh, yeah. Thanks. I forgot we can do that on. I do have, if anyone missed it, here is my gold medal flower sack that I found. It's just tiny. I think it's the cutest thing. And this is the pin that the woman gave me. She won her high school's search for the All-American Homemaker of Tomorrow in, let me see what year this was, 1955 from Delone Catholic High School. How about that? In Pennsylvania. Not too bad, right? I also found, I was at my local Goodwill a while ago and I found a Betty Crocker mug. I was so excited. I think this was made for like, it must've been a Betty Crocker, like a, you know, some kind of conference they had. It says leadership is sweet on the back, but. While you're thinking of questions, let me answer one that often comes up. I'm often asked, when did they come out with the red and white plaid cookbook? Do you remember a cookbook with red and white plaid on the cover? If that came to your mind, that's actually not the Betty Crocker cookbook. I know that you're probably thinking of the Better Homes and Gardens cookbook. Better Homes and Gardens also had a best-selling general cookbook. And the problem was, for all of us who get them mixed up, is that both the Betty Crocker cookbook and the Better Homes and Gardens cookbooks had red and white covers, and they had names that start with B-E-T-T. So you can see why we get them mixed up. But I have to look this up. The Better Homes and Gardens cookbook has sold 40 million copies since 1930. Betty Crocker's cookbook has sold about 75 million copies since 1950. Now, the Betty Crocker cookbook had the benefit of General Mills advertising behind it. But nonetheless, there's a distinctness. The other big one is The Joy of Cooking, which came out in 1931. That has sold about 18 million copies. So if you were a Joy of House Cooking home, that was another one of the big ones. Another fun bit of trivia, General Mills, the original Washburn Crosby factories in Minneapolis, are no longer there. But one of them was abandoned for a while. It has been transformed into a museum, the Mill City Museum, and it's all dedicated to the history of flour milling and specifically why so much flour milling was concentrated in Minneapolis, which it was. That area had a huge number, and it had a lot to do with power availability and being sort of in the agricultural center of the nation. It's kind of a fascinating thing if you ever go to Minneapolis. So, really, no questions? I can't believe I answered anything that might have come to. Oh, I know what I can tell you. If you are interested, since we're a library group, if you're interested in learning more, I do have a great book to recommend. There is a book called Finding Betty Crocker, and it's by a woman named Susan Marks. It's actually a very readable book. It's not an academic treatise. It's really a lot of fun, and she does a good job going through like the evolution of the portraits and things like that. So Finding Betty Crocker, I bet your local library could help you find it.
So we do have a question here.
Oh, great.
Marcy, go ahead.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
I was just starting to formulate my question, and when I went to type it into the chat box, I saw that it seemed to be disabled. So I need a little time to recollect what it was I wanted to ask.
Sorry about that.
Well, that's okay. I would like to tell you that I thought your presentation was superlative. It was so filled with so many great images. Sometimes I see presentations where the presentation is all the text that somebody is saying, and yours was the antithesis of that. And I thought I would be doing a jigsaw puzzle while I was listening to you, but I couldn't do my jigsaw puzzle because it was so filled with so many great images as you were speaking.
I'm glad. Because I have the same reaction as you do when there's a lot of text on the screens. I come from the museum world, so I like a lot of good images. So I'm glad you say that. Thanks. I feel the same way. Thanks.
Okay, we have another question. Actually, two more. Vivian?
Hi. Actually, I have the same problem. The chat was disabled. So I don't know if it's me or is it, you know, the system on your end. But what I want to say is, this is extremely interesting. I have the 1969 cookbook and I have kept it. Although I'm not a big cook, but every time I want dessert, like gingerbread or the other day, banana cream pie, I would go there. So those are, you know, trusted recipes because they're just simpler. You know, they don't have all the things that you can't find anymore,
but
true. very simple basic ingredients. So thank you very much. I really enjoyed this.
Do you know,
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm glad. It's so true. And a lot of people have those. In fact, if you find old copies, like in a used bookstore of a Betty Crocker cookbook, often you can tell which recipes became family standards because they're the ones that have drips on them. I was curious a couple years ago about what is the most popular Betty Crocker recipe, because I had this sense it was probably going to be some kind of dessert because, you know, it was a flour milling company's cookbook. So there's a lot of baking recipes. And it turns out it depends on how you define the most popular recipe, but it tends to be either chocolate chip cookies, which is kind of funny because I always thought, you know, I use the recipe on the Toll House package, or banana bread, which I thought was really interesting because, and banana bread has been in every edition of the Betty Crocker cookbook from the beginning. And it, in some ways it makes sense because banana bread to me feels like, it kind of feels like a treat. It's kind of like cake, but it's bananas. So it's healthy for us. So you don't feel quite as guilty. And I thought that was a really interesting way to kind of put Betty Crocker in the fact that we so often associate her with really good desserts.
So we have a couple other questions here. Sharon?
Yes, hi there. That was a wonderful presentation. Absolutely great. My husband stayed for the whole presentation too, so he enjoyed it. I happen to have the Betty Furness Westinghouse cookbook.
Oh, yeah.
And it's from 1954, my mother's. Was Betty Furness real?
Wait, that's a good question. I don't know. I'd have to look it up. I really don't. The one thing I will say is I'm always fascinated by how many companies, I mean, it's still not fascinated, but it's interesting how many companies developed recipes and came out with cookbooks using their products. I mean, it's an obvious and yet brilliant way to sell your products, but it kind of starts to work in the reverse in the sense that, you know, you start to, in other words, let me see if I'm thinking of that cookbook, and I'm also thinking about the General Foods cookbooks. They start out kind of, you know, we want to sell this, we want to make recipes that reflect the way people cook, and then they become really popular and they start actually shaping the way people cook. So you might put that, you know, I sort of put that one in that same category, but I don't know if she was real. We'll have to look it up.
Thank you.
Okay, Maureen?
I'm in New Jersey and I'm a groupie of female historical interpreters. So you give a plug to your website, Leslie, because that's where nice I found this.
Yes, I do. Because I have a background in theater, I do portrayals as well. So I do portrayals of famous women like Amelia Earhart and Jackie Kennedy and Eleanor Roosevelt and Julia Child, believe it or not, is one of those that I do. And I actually, when I started this talk, I had this thought about, you know, should I portray Betty Crocker? And it was a really funny dilemma because the historian in me was thinking, you know, I can't portray a fictional person, but the actor in me was interested in it. And I decided finally not to. But yes, if anyone's interested, my website, and I'll see if I can put it into, I don't know if I can put it into chat. So let me try. My website is just my name, LeslieGoddard.info. I live in the Chicago area, but thankfully, we've got Zoom, so I can present in a kind of, you know, easy way for audiences all over the country. So thanks.
Welcome. Thank you for a great presentation.
Oh, thanks.
Sharon, did I already get you?
Yes.
Okay, sorry about that. All right, did I miss anyone? Just raise your hand again if I did.
You hear what I did? I'm from Jersey.
Well, hopefully we're not leaving anybody feeling too hungry. So thank you everybody so much for being here. And thanks so much to the West Hartford Library for putting tonight together.
Yeah, thank you so much, Leslie. This was wonderful. So thank you so much for coming out tonight. Thank you everyone else for coming out tonight. It was a great turnout. So I guess everyone have a great night. Bye.
Thank you.